thank God once again for the opportunity given to us to be in His presence. We are going to receive from the Lord, and I want us all to open our hearts. It's my prayer that God will give us insight and revelation so that we'll be able to get in divine alignment.
Amen.
So that His blessing, His purpose, His plans for our lives will surely, truly manifest or come to pass. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
We're going to look at 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 9. I want to talk about God's purpose and plan for man, for you and for me. How God designed it and what He intended for us. We know, as Jeremiah says, that the plans of God for our lives, the Bible says that it is good and will bring us to what? An expected end. That is what the Lord assured the children of Israel, even in the time of their captivity. So God took them through and brought them to the rightful place at the right time. So let us look at the scripture as we read 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 9. It says, "But as it is written," something that is established, "I have not seen, nor ear heard, neither had entered into the heart of man the things which God had prepared for them that love Him." Hallelujah.
Amen.
He said, "I have not seen nor ear heard, neither have entered into the heart of man the things which God had prepared for them that love Him." Only for specific people. People who love the Lord. He says that God has good plans for them. Hallelujah.
Amen.
He says that what He has for them, nobody has comprehended it. No eye has seen, no ear heard. And Paul was trying to make the Corinthians understand that God has good things and good intention and blessings for us all. Hallelujah. So that's what we have to understand, that as many people blame God for things that happen here and there, you see that they are all mistaken and they are ignorant because they don't know what the word of God is saying. But God has good things for us. Because Satan is ruling the world, that is why he's manipulating things in his way. But people don't see him at work, but they only see a different picture and then they blame God. Hallelujah. But God is good and God will bring us an expected end, as it were, has said. Okay, so let us look at the plan. The theme, as he says, that the plan and purpose. A plan is an intention or decision about what one is going to do. Because when you want to do anything, you put down some things, you write some things down, and then arrange your timing and other things. What you are going to do, that's what we call plan. Amen. And purpose, as we also see from this meaning, he says that the reason for which something is done or created for, which something exists, why something exists is a purpose. Why something is done is a purpose. Hallelujah. So whatever we see in this area has a purpose. God had a purpose for man, and He had a plan also for man. He had an intention that man will enjoy life on earth, but man chose his way. That is why things are going the way they are going today. Hallelujah. But with God, He had a plan, He had His purpose and everything. So if we are able to get aligned into God's plan and purpose, we will enjoy fullness of His blessing. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Let us look at this long scripture from Genesis 2, 8 to 17 to give us a little picture of what God intended for man. Just get a picture and then we will continue. It says, from Genesis 2, 8 to 17, "The Lord God planted a garden eastward in Eden, and there He put the man whom He had formed. And out of the ground, the Lord God made every tree grow that is pleasant to the sight and good for food. The tree of life was also in the midst of the garden, and the tree of knowledge of good and evil. Now a river went out of Eden to water the garden, and from there it parted and became four river heads. The name of the first is Pishon. It is one which skirts the whole land of Havilah, where there is gold, and the gold of that land is crude. Bethlehem and onyx stones and there. The name of the second river is Gihon. It is the one which goes around the whole land of Cush. The name of the third river is Hiddekel. It is the one which goes towards the east of Assyria. The fourth river is the Euphrates. Hallelujah. 15 says, then the Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to tend and keep it. And the Lord God commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden you may freely eat, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat. For in the day that you eat of it, you shall surely die. Hallelujah. So when we look at the background or the big picture of this scripture, we see that God's intention and plan for man was that we will live good. So before man was formed or created, God already has planted a garden, made preparation for him to enjoy the best that he could do. God wanted to make a family on earth, bring whatever is in heaven. Heaven is a spiritual place, but he wanted to transform, make another type of heaven on earth, that lifestyle, so that man will enjoy it. We know that there's another Eden where Satan or Lucifer was created in heaven, and in the earth we have the physical one that God himself made and put Adam inside to enjoy. He said every pleasant food, anything that was there, even the tree of life was in there. And God planted another tree that was a tree of knowledge, good and evil. And he told the man that he should not eat of it. The day that he will eat, he will surely die. But he never expounded what the death and other things was to Adam. If you look at God, sometimes there are a lot of things that we don't understand. But God gives his command or word in a period, that is it. When he gives it, he gives it. He doesn't explain himself to you. God will say, don't eat that fish. The only thing we have to do is that we don't have to eat it. But sometimes we want to find out what is inside. Out of curiosity, people get into and they get themselves into trouble. Adam was asked not to eat that particular tree. Because God made him a man of free will, he did not want to force him in anything, but he told him, enjoy life. That is what man was intended to do. And he blessed him, empowered him, and told him that be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth. Anything that man needed on earth was given. Hallelujah. Amen. But as we see, or as we read from Genesis chapter 3, we saw that the woman whom God gave to the man was deceived by the serpent, that is the devil, and ate the forbidden tree, that tree that the devil said that the very day that you eat, you shall die. She was enticed by the devil and said that if you eat this tree, you will be like God. You will also know good, you know evil, you know everything about that. So she began to gaze on it and saw that, no, this one is good for food, and it will be nice. It was pleasant to the eye, very attractive, charming. So she went, took it, and ate it, and went to the husband and gave some to him, that Adam, and Adam also ate it. Instantly, they died. Spiritually, they were cut off from God. Why did Adam eat the food? If we read from the Bible says that, if you love me, keep my commandment. Here we could see that Adam loved the woman more than God. But God's command is that we have to love him first, above every other thing, even above our own lives. That's what God has said in his word. He said, love God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength. The second is love your neighbor as yourself. That's why he said that if you want to follow God, you have to do what? Take up your cross and follow him. Self have to be put aside. That means that our love for God should be the first. Adam never showed love for God from the beginning. So he disrespected the word of the Lord. That's why death came to the scene. He was cut off, and God threw him out of the garden because it was a pleasant place. The Bible says that he placed an angel there to stop anyone who wanted to come in, because he was aware that there was another tree which could lengthen his life. That was the tree of life, was there. So God put an angel there to stop whoever will be coming so that they don't touch that tree, so that they will be live in their sin. So that is what we see from the beginning. But one thing that we can also see from the word of God is that from Isaiah 46, 10 to 11, let me read it quickly. He said, declaring the end from the beginning and from ancient time, things that are not yet done, saying, my counsel shall stand and I will do my pleasure, calling a bird of prey from the east, the man who executed my counsel from a far country. Indeed, I have spoken it. I will bring it to pass. I have purposed it. I will also do it. Hallelujah. So God's word makes us understand that whatever God has purposed to do, it doesn't matter what, he will do it. He will surely bring it to pass. That is why when Adam fell, because of the deception, God never gave up on Adam. God tried to find a way to bring to pass what he has intended to do. Hallelujah. So God himself, when he looked for Adam, he clothed them and made a promise to him that he was going to bring the seed of the woman to bruise the head of the serpent that deceived him. God wanted to find a way to bring to pass what he has purposed to do. And by the grace of God, Jesus, who was the last Adam, came. So we were going to look into the scripture and then see the two different that we see. But as we keep on, let us look at God, what God was doing. Along the way, God called Abraham and decided to make a family from him. He was somebody whose heart was with him. So he called him out of his family and then told him to go to a place that he's going to bless, and that his seed was going to be a blessing to the nations through him. So God called Abraham, and through Abraham, God established Israel. Hallelujah. So Israel came out of him. They are the seed of Abraham. And then God made a law. Let us understand. A law was made for them. All this was a way of preparing his people to enjoy whatever he planned from the beginning. He never gave up on them. And this law, as long as the children of Israel obeyed the law, loving God with all their hearts, serving him, bringing their first fruit, their tithes, their offering, and sacrifices that they were supposed to do, as long as they did it, God was with them. Anything that they did prospered. And the Bible says that God made them great, lifted them above the nations. Even up to today, they are great people. When you want to talk about millionaires and scientists, they are them. They are the Jewish people. Hallelujah. Because God blessed Abraham and promised that he will make his children great. And he made his name great. So he did it and through his children. So we see that everything was just aligned accordingly, as he has said. Hallelujah. So God's dealing with, when we look at God's dealing with Israel, when they were coming out of Egypt, the Bible says that wherever they went, people feared them. Hallelujah. Mm-hmm. People feared them. The fear of God was surrounding them, God's presence surrounding them. So people feared them, and then when they were, as long as they were going, they were also conquerors. Anywhere that they stood, they fought, they were victorious. And what I want to say here was that as they were doing the will of God, they were operating under a different law. And the law of God is superior than the law of the earth. Hallelujah. So, let me use the law of gravity and the law of aerodynamics as an example, which will help us to understand very clearly what the intentions of God. So, as long as we remain in the will of God to do His will, because all that God wanted us to do was to do His will. His will was to obey His word. That is the final thing. Hallelujah. So as the children of Israel were in the will of God, the heaven's law was, they operated in the laws of heaven. So the Bible says that even as they walked in the wilderness, they were not sick. Their clothing did not worn out. They ate the food of angels because they were under a different law. A law of gravity, as we see, when you throw anything, it falls. So gravity will cause anything to be on the ground. But when it comes to aerodynamics, aerodynamics is another law that supersedes the law of what? Gravity. If we look at the aeroplane, for example, I don't think its weight is like a paper. Air can blow a paper, we can see it in the air, we sometimes will run to chase it and all those things. But look at how heavy, what do you call it, an aeroplane is. It is not normal feathers that you see that this thing can blow it. But when the engines are started, they have given some engines that runs. And then when it gets to some particular speed, it brings the law of aerodynamics in place. And so when the law, that law, begins to take over, the plane lifts up, hallelujah, and goes up. So it defies the law of gravity. The law of gravity have nothing, it cannot operate. So the aerodynamics law will lift the plane up and it will cause it to fly in the air and then begins to go. And as it moves, as long as the law is in place, it continues. If the law stops, immediately the law of gravity will take over and the plane will fall and it will go and to crash and death is going to take place. And that is what happened with the law of God and the laws of the earth. The laws of the earth are laws of the enemy. If we look at every kind of law that is coming from the countries and are laws of the earth, which leads to what? Self, which is outside the will of God. God has intended that we always remain in His will. So the moment we get outside the will of God, we come onto another law, that is the law of gravity, which will always bring us down. But the Bible says the moment we believed, we got seated in heavenly places. That is the law of aerodynamics has lifted us to sit with Christ. That's why that we are walking. So as long as we obey the word of God fully, what has made the church lose its power is mixing tradition, mixing the laws of the earth with the word of God. When the pure word of God is being followed, we will walk in a different law. That is like the law of aerodynamics. That's why the Bible says that those that wait upon the Lord, they shall mount up with wings. And you know that eagles operate on aerodynamics law. They are not operating the law of gravity. That is why they lift themselves up and they are soaring. And the Bible says that when we wait upon the Lord, waiting brings us into His presence and into His will to do what He desires us to do. And as we begin to do it, we'll be in that will. So in everything, we'll be above. Because if you are operating under the laws of God, gravity cannot bring you down. In everything, you excel. That's why the Bible says that if you obey this, I will lift you above the nations. That is the law of aerodynamics. That is the law of heaven, bringing you a lift, because heaven is above. So when you begin to obey the laws of heaven, you will live above the things of the earth. But the moment we begin to operate, oh, compromise here, compromise there, gravity will bring you to a crash. So you see that people who don't obey the word of the Lord, that's why there's a lot of problem in marriage lives, in everything, because we are bringing the system, the tradition of men into the marriage instead of the word of God. Because God had, if you want to understand marriage, let us go to Genesis, what God put down. That is the anything that we want to see. In Genesis, we can get the whole picture. The plan that God had for man to enjoy in Genesis. Everything was there before the man fell. So when we leave it, and so we have to please, we have to do the, gravity will bring us down. That is why even in the body of Christ, there are a lot of divorces here and there. People don't understand themselves. Because the word of God, the laws of heaven, have been removed from there. And let us take, for example, I'm going to use another example, where there's always provision. Anytime we are in the will of God, God makes sure there's provision. If you look at ambassadors or consulates who are in another country, where they are, the office and the house, that building, that particular building that is there, represent the nation that they come from. If somebody is being chased by the police and he runs into that building, the police cannot catch him. Because that place alone is covered by a different law. The loss of the land does not affect the person who enters there or people who are living there. The embassy or the consulate, because he's been sent by his nation, he's paid by his nation, every supply that he needs comes from the nation. Because he's being there is to do what his nation has ordered him to do. He doesn't do anything contrary. His pay and everything is according to his nation. They pay him, make sure that he lives well. Everything is supplied. The same thing is the believer. We are ambassadors of Christ who have been sent from there. That's why the Lord said that, the Bible says that we are in this world, but we are not of the world. So when we are obeying the word of God, living according to the word of God, we are under a different law. And that law brings us above the nation. When the economy of nations are crashing, we don't have to complain because we are living in a different law. God supplies our needs. We will be exempted. We will be protected. There's immunity. That's why I said that when somebody runs to an embassy, he's safe. There was a man that, I've forgotten the name, he said WikiLeaks or something. He has run to the Australian embassy in here in UK, and they can't catch him. He is there like somebody in house arrest. When he comes out, they'll catch him. But as long as he's there, it's like political asylum in that country. That means that he's in Austria, in UK. The same thing, when you go to any place, the laws in that embassy, it's a different law altogether. That things of the land doesn't concern. How the people live, it doesn't concern them. They have a different law. I remember somebody said he went to Ghana, and then when he went to, the Caribbean were there at the embassy. So when he started speaking Italian, he was allowed in. You see that in that place, it is the Italian law that governs there. It's not the Ghana law that operates over there. You meet the Carabinier, everything that is in here is there. You see the thing? So that's how it is. We are all ambassadors. So as long as we remain in the will of God, in the word of God, we come or receive the supply of heaven. We are protected, we receive the best from God. So when the last Adam came, that was Jesus, he came to preach the kingdom. Hallelujah. Amen. So let us look at his message from Matthew chapter 4, verse 17. It says, from that time Jesus began to preach and say, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. So we see that Jesus came to preach about the kingdom of heaven. Because that time, men have deviated from their calling and their cause. They were outside the will of God. They were doing their own thing. So Jesus came to introduce the life in heaven. So when he was preaching, that was his way. And when he was even teaching us how to pray, in Matthew chapter 6, 9 and 10, let us take this in clear. Matthew 6, 9 and 10. He says, in this manner, therefore, pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done. We have read this over and over and over. But I want us to ponder over that area that says that your kingdom come and your will be done. Because the will of God alone is what can sustain us and what will manifest the plans of God for our lives. If we depend on our will, we will be under gravitational law. We will always be below. Gravity will always bring you down. But when the law of aerodynamics takes place, it lifts you from the law of gravity. So you go above. Hallelujah. So if we look at Jesus Christ, his lifestyle on earth, let us look at what he said from John 6:38. John chapter 6, verse 30. He says that, for I came down from heaven not to do my own will, but the will of him that sent me. Hallelujah. He said he came to do the will of him that sent him. So the first Adam came to do his will. That is why he was cast away from the Garden of Eden, where he was supposed to enjoy. But the last Adam, that is Jesus, when he came, he said, I didn't come to do my will. He could have had houses, built, did many, many things, but that was not his purpose. He said he came to do the will of the Father. And that is what we are supposed to seek for. As long as we do his will, there will be supply. So Jesus was walking in the laws of heaven. That is why he walked on water. The law of gravity is something that is on earth. He was not affected. So we always see it as what? Miracle. So when he was walking on water, he was walking in the laws of heaven. That was, as I put it, like the law of aerodynamics was operating in his life. Even when he died and rose, the Bible says he ascended, like the power of aerodynamics, that is spiritual law, lifted him to where he came from. Hallelujah. When it came to food, he would just try to test the disciples. Many people, thousands, feed them. If we're supposed to be under earthly law, as the people were saying that, how can these few loaves and these fishes feed these people? But because he was operating on another law, he said, bring it. He just give thanks and he invoked the laws of heaven on it and said, begin to break it. And then as they break it, begins to multiply. Thousands of people. The Bible will say 5,000, but in actual fact, it's about 15,000 or maybe 20,000. Because that time, when they counted people, women were not counted, only men. And if there were women, at least some will have children, two, three, and so, all of them will eat. So he fed many because he was operating under a different law. And his purpose was to do the will of God. As long as he was in his will, that law was in place. So he was exceptional. He was a great minister of God who had people that he was feeding, disciples. He paid their taxes and everything. Where did he get the money? Well, he was operating under a different law. So money was nothing to him. Anything that he needed, he had it. When he was being accused and sentenced, he told Pilate that it is given to him, but like he would not be able to touch him. He said he can even command legions of angels from his kingdom to come and fight. That's from another kingdom. He said legion, thousands. But look at the Bible in Revelation saying that even the whole devil himself, only one angel, Not even two angels will come and hold. One angel will hold him and cast him into the bottomless pit. So you see that God is powerful and omniscient and everything. So as long as the last Adam came to do the will of God, he never complained sickness because he was not under the earthly laws. He was operating on the laws of heaven. And in the kingdom, with the laws of heaven, there's no sickness there. So he doesn't get sick. No complaints of headache, no lack of money and other things. All these things are all earthly. Because whatever he needed, all that he needed was to do was give thanks, and then the Father brings them. Because the Father always supplies. As long as we are in his will, he will bring supply. He will send angels. The Bible says when even Jesus Christ was praying, when he was going to face the cross, the Bible says that angels came to strengthen him. So when we need strength, he will send strength from above. Hallelujah. So we have to understand, for us to enjoy divine supply, divine health, divine immunity, we have to be or do the will of God. Obey the word of God. We don't have to mix it with tradition. Or because we have come to somebody's country, this is the way they do things, we follow. As it is saying that when you go to Rome, you do what the Romans do. It does not apply in the kingdom. Hallelujah. Some certain areas, it does not apply. But when you apply, go to Rome, do what the Romans do, gravity, you'll be down. Hallelujah. Amen. You will crash. But when you do what heaven does in every place, you will always be above. Because that is a law that will always lift you. And when sin and other things comes in, you are above. You will fall. You crash. That's why many people crash and a lot of things. So if we want to enjoy life in its fullest, we have to do the will of God. That is the word of God. Joshua was asked that he should meditate on the word of God day and night. He should never leave to the left or right. And as he did it, he said that every promise that God made came to pass. He was able to conquer his enemies. So all that we have to do is to make sure we do what? We do the will of God. But Jesus said that he did not come to do his will, but the will of the Father. But when Adam came, when what the Lord told him, he did not do. God wanted him to do his will, not to touch that tree, but only to till or to work in the garden and then eat freely and then multiply, do whatever he wanted to. But he chose his will. The moment we choose our will, we want things in our favor. We will be always, gravity will bring us down. So whoever you see them who have this revelation knowledge and excelling, they are operating on another law. That is the laws of God. Whether in ministry, whatever. It is the laws of God that is governing, and it will always lift you up. So anything that God has also not designed, he will not come in to support it, whether it's a business or whatever. It is not in his will. You cannot blame him because he has not ordained it. Everything is supposed to be in his will. Sometimes we say permissive will. All this long, we have to put it aside and look for what he has intended for us to do. That's why he's saying that his thoughts for us is not of evil, but good to bring us to an expected end. He said what he has planned for us, ears have not heard or eyes even seen. For those who love him, and it is those who love him who will do his will. Because if we love God, as we normally say, we are afraid of men. When we are going to work, we make sure we are not late. But we are going to church, we relax. And sometimes, if it is 8 o'clock, we get there 9 o'clock. We don't love God. If we really love God, we will put him first. We fear him. We will do everything about God. Anything connected with God, we'll put it first. And take caution about it. Hallelujah. And that is his will. So when we begin to do it, we will see the blessings of God manifesting. Because there's a law that surpasses another law. Anytime we compromise with any other law or a people's experience or whatever, experience and other things, there are some kind of knowledge that helps us. But we don't dwell on those things. But our path is to dwell on the word of God. And as long as we do the will of the word of God, it it is the will of God, we will walk in another law. And that law, there's no decay. That law, there's immunity. You are always protected. Angels surrounding you, there's always supply. That's why the Bible says, seek ye first the kingdom and his righteousness, and all other things shall be given unto you. What Jesus was saying was really true. Because as we seek God's kingdom, the supply, he is going to do the supply. But it's another law. When you begin to think about what you're going to eat, what you're going to wear, and all those things, they are all natural things. It's under another different law. So people who think about this always operate in the gravity level. But when you begin to think about the things of God, the Bible says that even if you give to the work of God or you sow above, you see that place, you have an account where moth or whatever will not corrupt it. It is high above. That's what Jesus said. So we are people that are always supposed to be above. In our waiting on the Lord, it brings us into another level. So let us always desire to operate in the laws of God. That law surpasses the laws of the earth. It cuts across. That is why people in the Bible who were operating in that law were not affected by many, many things that happened. Daniel was a man of prayer. He was operating on the heavenly law. So when they lied about him, put him in the lion's den, because of that different law, the lions did not see him as food. He was not eating. He came out freely. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they were operating on a different law. So the earthly law, fire, could not consume them because they were obeying the will of God. They went in the fire, danced, they praised the Lord, and even the king himself was surprised. It was another law that was in operation. Hallelujah. Let us look at Esther. Esther understood when there was danger, when he accepted to go before the king. He applied a different law. The Bible says that law in that place was, when the king stamped it, it cannot be reversed. But when he entered into prayer and fasting, that law was broken. And when he went before the king, the scepter was pointed to her, and she was able to stand on behalf of his people. God used her to bring deliverance. She was operating on a different law. So when we begin to pray, the Bible says men always ought to pray and not to faint. Prayer brings us closer to God. And as long as we are closer to God, it weakens the flesh and then brings the things of God. That is the law of God in place in our lives. And as we keep on in this area and operate in the laws of God, we will always be above. There will not be limitations. We will be operating in the aerodynamic law. And it is a super law that cuts across any other physical law. So when you are operating in that law and you are going to any place, you don't fear. Because the law that you are in is powerful than that law. Sometimes they will see your face and then they begin to, anything that you, they will do it, because a different law is operating and a different law has come to that place. Hallelujah. So let us learn to operate in the laws of God. Because God has good plans, good blessing, a lot of things for us that eyes haven't seen, nor ears heard. But the moment we begin to look at self, I have to do this, I, it will bring us to gravity, gravitational law. It brings you down. But when you see God alone, the will of God be done. This, I have to please God. Is God happy about what I'm doing? If not, it doesn't matter how it looks attractive, I will not do. Only God. You are in a different law. And that law, anywhere you go, you cannot be denied. Hallelujah.
Amen.
You will always excel. So let us pray that God will help us, that it doesn't matter how, we will be able to stand to operate in the kingdom. Jesus operated under a different law. That's why his work and everything was different. His preaching was different. The Bible says that people heard, he said, no, this man, the way he preaches, I don't understand. They sent soldiers, go and arrest him. They went and they came and said, the way this man preached. They said, hey, but have you also been deceived? Because he was at a different law. And his words alone brought healing to people. His words brought deliverance. Hallelujah. So these two laws, let us remember it, the law of gravity and the law of aerodynamics. Anyone who operates in the law of God is operating in the law of aerodynamics, which will always bring you a lift. And when this law is in place, it doesn't matter where you are, you will be lifted. If a plane doesn't lift, I don't think it will, something might happen, it might explode. But that law is in place. When that law is working, it brings it up, lift it up, 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 and it goes. So as we get into closer to God to do his will, we will be in another law. The law that overcomes the law of the earth. Hallelujah. I want us to pray and ask God, Lord, help us. Sometimes it gets to a place and then something will cause you to compromise. Let us pray that God will grant it his grace that we will not compromise. It doesn't matter how the world is going, because all the world, the fashion, everything that is going are all under gravity. But if we look at what God wants, God will always bring us above. It doesn't matter what. Hallelujah. God will bring us above it. Some people will say Christianity is in the heart. Though it's in the heart, but anything that is in the heart, the Bible says that if it is above, it will come out. So you can look at somebody and know his level spiritually. Amen. So let us not compromise. Let us not take what other people's, the way they are doing their things, and then whether they are walking in the flesh or whatever, and then begin to say that, oh, he's going well, oh, he preached better, he did this, so you are following. Let us make sure that we are in the Word of God, in his will. His will, the law in it, is powerful than anything on the earth, and to make us overcome. Hallelujah. Shall we stand and pray? Asking God for grace to be able to stand for him.